It's my pleasure to and privilege to introduce Secretary of State Madeleine Albright.
Great. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all very much. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Please, thank you. Thank you very much, President Flanagan, and I appreciate the step up here. And you can well imagine what it was like for me talking to Senator Muskie at 6. I'm really honored to be here today and delighted to see so many friends. And Mark, that was terrific. I really enjoyed listening to you, as I always do. Terrific. Even though it has been decades that we've all been together, we members of the Muskie team have a very warm and ongoing relationship, and it's really, every time we see each other, it's kind of like the political equivalent of a high five. And we really have been and will always continue to work together. So if we're a little overly exuberant today, I think you'll understand. While I relish being with my Muskie family, what most appealed to me about coming here to Portland was the opportunity to speak to all you people here about life and the legacy of this incredible human being. And that's why I'm especially pleased to see so many students here from the Muskie School of Public Service. Ed Muskie was without a doubt one of my heroes, and I first met him in 1972 when I volunteered to help raise money for that campaign, and we became friends, and later I went to work for him as his chief legislative assistant. Senator Muskie was what you would call old school. He worked extremely hard, took his committee assignments seriously, thought public service was a noble profession, and cursed a bit. Although he always tried to shield me from some of the things he said, he seemed to be embarrassed to curse in front of women. He was one of the best teachers I ever had, even though I didn't adopt all his vocabulary. I am a diplomat, after all, but then again, so is he. I learned a tremendous amount from Senator Muskie merely by observing him as he worked both in public and in private. He could be tough to work for because he expected all of his staffers to keep up with his furious pace, and for me, that meant long hours away from my daughters, who were always interested in what I did, but I had made a rule that I'd always would take any phone call that my children made in the office. But one time, I was working over on the Senate floor with the senator, and my daughter called. So when I came home, Katie said, "So, Mom, what exactly were you doing on the floor with Senator Muskie?" So I had to explain what happened on the Senate floor, and it was her early civics lesson. And Senator Muskie always loved Katie, and maybe it's because when she was like 4 years old, we were all together, and she looked up at him, and she said, "Senator Muskie, are you a giant?" And he certainly was. The purpose of this conference is not to canonize Ed Muskie or those who worked for him, although I think we'd all be open for that, but rather we're here to talk about the lessons that he taught us and how they're relevant to the challenges facing our country today. Needless to say, there's an awful lot to discuss, and I really look forward to answering your questions later, and since I'm no longer in the government, I'll actually be able to answer them. The timing of this conference is fortuitous, coming after a hard-fought, divisive, and downright nasty election season. As we saw during the election, the American people's long-simmering frustration with Washington is boiling over. Voters, and non-voters for that matter, sent a message that they want their leaders to stop bickering and get things done. President Obama and the new Republican leadership in Congress have said that they've gotten the message, but while both parties now have a stake in governing, we don't know whether the next 2 years will be marked by confrontation or, as Mark said, that all-important word, compromise. It's easy to be pessimistic. Political courage is in short supply these days, and the art of compromise seems to have become extinct, like the dodo bird or the flip phone. That is unfortunate, because whether you blame Republicans or Democrats for the gridlock on Capitol Hill, there's no denying that it hurts our country and our standing abroad. So Americans of both parties are fed up. They want their leaders to reach across the aisle and forge consensus on the tough issues of the day, whether it's setting fiscal priorities, crafting policies on energy and climate change, or tackling tough foreign policy challenges. They know it's possible to govern this way, yet few are aware, except perhaps those in this audience, that a senator from Maine named Ed Muskie was a leading practitioner of this approach. He set the standard for a politician who was both principled and practical, and his example is one that our leaders today would be wise to follow as they seek to govern a divided nation. I was fortunate to witness the qualities that distinguished Ed Muskie from other less successful leaders, and I think these qualities are worth mentioning because they're so needed in Washington today. First, he was a consensus builder who understood that bipartisanship was not a four-letter word. For Muskie, no party had a monopoly on wisdom. He worked closely with Republicans, and even though he was a loyal Democrat, he infuriated many when he asked, "What's so damn liberal about wasting money?" When he became chairman of the newly established Budget Committee, his first instinct was to make sure that he and all of us reached out to his ranking member, Republican Henry Bellman of Oklahoma. His proudest moments came when his major legislative achievements, obviously including the Clean Air and Clean Water Act, passed with unanimous support from both parties. A second important quality was his mastery of critical thinking, which meant asking tough questions, never being satisfied, considering every option, and studying every issue until he understood it even better than the experts did. He absorbed the details and nuances of legislation and established a process for crafting bills that was inclusive, rational, and fact-based. He knew when to be conciliatory as he elicited information and forged coalitions, and he knew when to use that famous temper to hold officials accountable and stop opponents cold. This approach made him very effective at getting things accomplished, but in doing so, he never compromised his principles, and that's the third quality that distinguished Ed Muskie as a leader. He was considered by many to be the conscience of the Senate, and his strong sense of right and wrong were what attracted so many of us to his cause. Whether we were interested in state government or just plain good government, clean air and water, a budget process that worked, a generous foreign policy that reflected our goodness and strength, or just because we believed in politics and principles that they go together. Ed Muskie inspired us and showed the nation how government could be a force for good in people's lives. That should be self-evident, but it seems that not everyone gets that today. More and more, we have a certain brand of politician telling us that our government is the source of all evil, and that people in Washington want nothing more than to deprive citizens of their rights. According to their line of thinking, the government does no good, and so there's little to be lost by shutting it down or by creating an endless cycle of gridlock. To use a diplomatic term of art, that is balderdash. When I was a child in Europe, my family was driven twice from its home, first by the Nazis and then by the communists, so I'm well aware that power can be abused. But I have to point out that one of the reasons we love America so much is that in our country, the government is not the enemy. The government is us. No one wants our bureaucracy to be bigger than it needs to be, but neither can anyone deny that our public servants play an essential role. In providing security, ensuring order, building infrastructure, helping the disadvantaged, curbing pollution, and safeguarding the health of our people. And a big part of the reason our government can do these things, I should add, is Ed Muskie. I should also add that when I was Secretary of State, I traveled to many countries that might be considered a libertarian paradise because the hand of government is so weak. For example, in the Congo, there are no burdensome environmental regulations. In Haiti, the insurance mandate is not a problem. In parts of South Asia, factory owners do not have to worry about the safety inspections. And in Somalia, you can buy an assault weapon without the time-consuming hassle of a background check. Beyond that, in quite a few nations, the government does not have the resources to pay for power plants, clean water, paved roads, Medicare, Social Security, or independent courts. And the only police are the kind that hold you up instead of helping you out. That is not my vision of America, and it certainly was not Ed Muskie's vision. The men and women who founded our country loved freedom, but their purpose in coming together was not to eliminate government. Their goal was to create order out of chaos, and they did this by creating a system of checks and balances that for more than two centuries has enabled our society to prosper and grow. And for all its shortcomings, the government they conceived should be an object of pride for all our citizens, in part because it remains a source of admiration and envy across the globe. That status is of special importance today, when the art of governing has become more and more complicated, and it seems that everything that can go wrong in the world is going wrong. It's easy to look at the challenges facing our nation and conclude that the United States has become weaker. But the truth is that our country has always faced hard challenges. Two generations ago, the Japanese attacked us and the Germans declared war. In 1950, North Korea invaded the South, unworried about what we might do. In the 1960s, we became bogged down in Vietnam. In the 1970s, our diplomats were taken hostage in Iran, and in the 1980s, more hostages were seized and our embassy in Beirut was bombed. In the 1990s, we celebrated the end of the Cold War, but that was by no means the end of history. In the past 25 years, we have wrestled continually with such issues as terrorism, nuclear proliferation, the promotion of democracy, and the prevention of ethnic cleansing and genocide. It is a myth to believe that there was a time when the United States could do whatever it wanted in the world. We've always had to work with others, persuade others, and to negotiate with others on the basis of mutual interest and shared goals, and in every era, we have been opposed by some. That opposition is not a symptom of weakness. On the contrary, Senator Robert Kennedy once said, if there was no one standing in your way, it would be because we weren't going anywhere. And America wouldn't be America if we were not always on the move. So democracy can be loud, messy, half-baked, and inefficient, but we must always remember that it provides the best way for any society to make progress. While dictatorships crumble, free societies renew themselves through a constant process of debate, competition, innovation, and the ability to benefit from the contributions of all their people. As you know, I wasn't born in this country, and you can't imagine how proud I was as an immigrant to fly around the world as Secretary of State on a plane that carried the label United States of America and then to sit behind a sign that said the United States. And whenever I returned to the State Department, I was equally proud to see the official portrait I had put into my office of my hero, friend, and mentor, Ed Muskie, hanging there looking over me every day. It never occurred to me, as I'm sure it never did to him, to think of the job as representing one party to the exclusion of another. There is no partisan divide on the importance of liberty, the need to defend our citizens, the sacred nature of our commitments, or the desire to live in security and peace. We may not agree on everything, but on these points at least, I trust that we will always see eye to eye. There's no doubt that we're living through a time of bitter division at home, but my hope is that by reflecting on one person's life and legacy this afternoon, we will be able to look beyond the battles of this past election to see the true strength and unity of America at its best. And that is where the Muskie School of Public Service comes in, and I would like to conclude with a challenge to all of you here. Those of you who will graduate from the University of Southern Maine this spring are probably about 22 years old. And by comparison, South Africa's beloved patriarch, Nelson Mandela, spent 27 years, the prime of his life, in prison. As a victim of racism and persecution, Mandela could have used that time to nurture his bitterness and allow anger to grow. Instead, he devoted his many hours of solitude to learning about the people who put him in jail, the Afrikaners. He studied their language, history, grievances, and fears. So when he was finally released, he was not only able to understand those who'd imprisoned him, he was able to communicate with them, find common ground with them, forgive them, and most astonishingly, to lead them. Mandela knew that the surest way to defeat his enemies was not to make them do what he wanted, it was to persuade them to want what he wanted. He led his jailers to a new understanding of their own interests. And in so doing, he reminded us that we're all in the need of new understandings from time to time. Now, this afternoon, I'm not suggesting that any of you, students or alumni or friends, cast aside your opinions or downgrade the value of your perspectives. And I'm not asking you to pretend that we're all the same, because we're not all the same. And life would be incredibly boring if we were. I ask only that you make a real effort to keep learning. Instead of listening only to people whose views make you the most comfortable, study instead those who make you the most upset. By the way, as I drive through Washington, I listen to Rush Limbaugh, and it's amazing I haven't killed somebody. Instead of surrounding yourself with friends whose experiences are similar to yours, reach out to classmates and friends whose life stories are unknown. Instead of repeating over and over again the opinions you've expressed in the past, stop venting for a month. Ask yourself why you believe as you do, and submit your conceptions of truth to the rigorous standards of critical thinking. And above all, understand that there's an enormous difference between entering into an argument for the purpose of winning and engaging in dialogue to stretch your mind and awaken your conscience. One path may earn you a reputation as a brilliant advocate, but the other will guide you towards wisdom. And in saying all of this, I'm neither conceding that all truth is relative, nor implying that every point of view is equal in merit. On the contrary, I'm proposing that we place our deepest faith in principles that have proven themselves through decades of testing and struggle. These are ideas that bring people closer instead of driving them apart, ideas that challenge us to think not once but continually, ideas that demand the best from each of us while honoring the rights of all. And they include support for justice, believe in freedom, respect for the dignity of every human being, a commitment of lifelong learning, a willingness to forgive, and a desire to pursue truth wherever that quest might lead. At his memorial service in 1996, I said that Ed Muskie made history because he understood history. A lot of it he read, a lot of it he experienced personally, and what he didn't know, he would always ask about. So as you go forward, I ask you to do the same. Put faith in your values, but learn, think critically, and always make life an adventure, and you may be surprised by what you can achieve. And no matter where you go or what you do, always remember the people who inspired you. For me, that person is and was Ed Muskie. I truly loved him because of what he did for our country, for what he taught me, and for the wonderful friends that he left for all of us. Thank you all very much for your kindness.